Hi, this is Doug White. Welcome to the first ever premiere episode of Secure Digital Life. It's a snowy day here in New England, but we're going to take a look at some new security concepts to get you introduced to trying to be, well, better at everything. Because why not? I'm outside. I'm never outside because, you know, usually I'm inside with my computer where it's dry and warm and all those good things, but I'm outside. So just to introduce you to some of these ideas, we're going to talk today about the idea of phishing. You hear about it, you're excited about it, you know people do it, and you don't want it to happen to you. But it can, and it's really easy to get drawn into phishing attacks. So let's just say for a second that you're walking down the street, and you're walking down this snowy street that you see here in front of me, and, well, guess what happens next? On the ground, right there in front of you, you find a flash drive. It's a free flash drive. Why not? Now you have a free, one-of-a-kind flash drive that you can take home with you and use to do whatever you want with. Well, here's the problem. Sometimes bad guys decide that they're going to give you free flash drives because that's an awfully easy way to put stuff in your pocket to take inside your place of business or your home. Well, that's what phishing is all about. Is this a bad flash drive? It could be, but then again, it may not. So on this episode, episode number one, the first premiere episode of Secure Digital Life, Russ and I are going to talk about phishing attacks, how they work, and how you can try to avoid getting phished in the future. So I'll see you there. Hi, this is Secure Digital Life. My name's Doug White. I'm the chair of Cybersecurity Network at Roger Williams University. I am a private investigator, which is really cool to have, even though I'm not very good at it. I'm a digital forensicator, and I have been for a long time, and I swear I'm going to quit any day now. I am a network engineer and a programmer from way back, and I am one of the co-hosts of this cool program that we're putting together for you. My other host is Russ Boschman.
Hi, I'm Russ Boschman. I am the program advisor for cybersecurity and networking at Roger Williams University, as well as the director of instructional support and technology innovation. And welcome to Secure Digital Life, our first episode. And
that's
we're
right.
Super excited.
It's episode one.
Yay.
I mean, yay. It's like, how can you imagine that it's like episode one, and then like someday we'll go back and look at this and go, wow. That's
episode one minus Jar Jar Binks.
Don't even say that. We're not allowed to say that. So one of the things that came up, and the reason this show exists, is because we've co-hosted on Security Weekly and other shows like this. And one of the interests was that maybe somebody should come along and talk about basic topics in security, because I know a lot of people out there are interested in these things. And so we're going to try to take this show and talk about basic ideas of security and try to help you get a feel for what some of these things are that people are talking about in Security Weekly and get everybody up to speed.
And they ask us things like, you know, my phone is on a wireless network. Am I in danger? Or, you know, how do I protect myself from getting hacked? And things like, you know, VPN come up. And they're like, well, what's a VPN and how does it work? And so that's really what the focus of the show is all about, not just on VPNs, but on principles and security information that we are going to share with you at a basic fundamental level so that you too can protect yourself from all these threats that are out there.
Yeah, we're going to try to talk about all kinds of topics on this show. I mean, we deal with all sorts of things. I've done cases where people are saying, I sent some files to a friend and, like, were they bad files? They could be, like, pictures, and now I'm seeing them all over the world with different names on them, and what do I do? So we want to talk about things like that. We're going to talk about hacking things. We're going to talk about how to secure stuff that you have. We're going to talk about how to secure stuff at your house, and we're going to try to do that every week if we can. I hope that would be, if you want to watch. I mean, that's sort of the key to it, is that you have to watch us.
Twitter. We have a Twitter account.
Yeah, we do. We have secure at Secure Digital Life. So I'm going to be on there, and I'm going to try to tweet. I'm not the biggest tweeter, but I'm going to give it a shot. So.
Yep. And so we'll do some back channeling, live back channeling on the show. Send us your questions at Secure Digital Life.
Yeah, that sounds cool.
Yeah, and so we're here to rock your world.
We'll see you out there. Welcome to Secure Digital Life. And you type in AAA porn or whatever it is you're typing in. I was a PG show.
And I'm really excited to be here.
I'm glad you're here because somebody needs to know what's going on.
That's right.
Okay.
So now somebody has to drink this.
It's another day. It's another episode.
Yeah, he's looking at the wrong camera.
You put my camera over here. Cut. Basically, forget you ever saw that. I think actually forgetting you ever saw that would really be a good idea at this point. Hi, this is Doug White again. Only now I'm not outside. I'm not in the snow. Everything is nice and warm here in the studio. So we're talking about phishing and spear phishing on the first ever episode of Secure Digital Life. I'm here with Russ Boschman, the coolest guy around, who is sitting right there beside me with another coffee, because we all have coffee cups because it's daytime. But we want to have a show that will help you guide your way through phishing, other security threats, who knows what, so that you can try to improve things around your home and at your job. So, I've been working in security. If you don't know who I am, and I just, being a total narcissist, assume everybody knows who I am all the time, have been doing this stuff since the 70s, if you can imagine that. So I'm almost as old as Paul. And if you don't know who Paul is, well, watch Security Weekly. And I've been a programmer. I've been a network engineer. I've been a pen tester. I've been a physical pen tester. So I broke into things. And right now I teach cybersecurity courses and networking courses at Roger Williams University. And I'll let Russ tell you about him.
Hi, everyone. My name is Russ Boschman. I am good friends with Doug White here on my left. And I also teach and work at Roger Williams University in the cybersecurity and networking and digital forensics programs. And so welcome to our show. And I'm really excited to be here.
I'm glad you're here because somebody needs to know what's going on.
That's right.
And like, you know,
Who better to tell them than us?
Yeah, exactly. I'm just guessing. So cybersecurity is a big topic, and a lot of people are concerned about it. We've seen stuff like last week they released a report called Grizzly Step, which has this like bizarre name that confuses everybody. Instead of calling it the report on cybersecurity attacks during the election, they called it Grizzly Step, which makes everybody wonder what it really means. Mm-hmm. But one of the big keys in that was something called phishing and spear phishing that was done to the Democratic National Committee and other players in the electoral process. And I thought that would be a great way to start our show because if you call the FBI, don't do this, but I talk to the FBI when I see them, and it's always good, and I always ask them, what's the most common thing that you're running into right now? And when I talk to them, they almost always say phishing attacks and spear phishing attacks. And honestly, this is the best way to get people, because any great hacker will tell you that the single best way to get things is the easiest way. You don't need to be an elaborate C programmer or a firmware developer to go in and target somebody with these kind of attacks. And that's why they're done so commonly, because it's so much easier than trying to develop zero-day exploits or any of these kind of complex things. So people target people with spear phishing. So I thought we should talk a little bit about what is phishing. I'll let Russ tell you.
Sure. So many of you may know what phishing is. They just don't perhaps know the textbook definition of it. But phishing is where people send you emails. We'll use emails here in this case. They'll send an email to you in your inbox. Like, they'll say, okay, well, you know, this is Citizens Bank regarding your account ending in digits 2156 or something like that. And then it says below that or beneath that, you know, hey, you might want to come and check your balance, you know, there's an issue with, or we want to give you free $10, whatever, you know, click log in here and just accept the offer. And then, like, I mean, I probably would do it too. You click on the, or I have in the past, click on the button, log in, and oh no, this is not Citizens Bank anymore. Yeah. We've left Kansas and Toto's gone and he's dead. And now what you've done, no, me neither. And now what has happened is you have transmitted your bank's login in your login information from your bank account to somebody sitting on the side.
Right.
And then
I mean this stuff is derivative of what is a bigger picture called social engineering. Mm-hmm.
And way back in the 70s and the 80s, there were a lot of early hackers, and one of them, a very famous one, was named Kevin Mitnick. And one of Kevin Mitnick's big things was called social engineering. And Kevin Mitnick wasn't writing sophisticated programs that were attacking things. He was just literally doing what people always call con men. And he would call people and talk them out of things. And when I was first working for a bank long time ago, back in the 80s, and one of our jobs at the bank was to test security. And I constantly just called people and got them to give me information over the telephone. Mm-hmm. I would call up from a payphone, and if you don't know what a payphone is, we'll have to do a whole show on that. but there was such a thing as a payphone, and it meant it was this awful, greasy thing that some bizarre, really smelly person probably licked or something that was down by a diner. And I would sit in my car, and I would call the bank, and the phone would ring, ding, ding. Instead of ringing a regular ring, it would do this outside call ring. And no matter how much we train people, I could still get them to give me their credentials, because I would call them up and I would do things like, "Hi there, this is Bill. I'm in the human resources department of the bank, and there is a hacker," and you couldn't make quotes on payphones, but you get the idea. There was a hacker working in the bank, and in the 80s, people really worried about this, but they didn't know much about it. And I would say, "Okay, the hacker's using your account. We need to validate, are you the hacker? Because somebody's getting fired. So what I need you to give me is, could you give me your employee ID number?" And the people would just almost, "Oh, yeah, let me get that for you. And like, I need your mother's maiden name and your date of birth and, like, your kids' names and maybe, like, your driver's license number. And just leave the keys to your car and, like, that box down there that says Doug White, and we'll be good." And they would do it. And it became a really a big problem. Now, so spear phishing, which I can't resist telling you about, spear phishing then becomes targeted attacks, because if I know something about you, it's even better. Mm-hmm. Because if I can come right at you and I can give you something that means something to you, it's a lot easier than this thing about, "There's a Nigerian prince and he's got, I don't know, what's a good number for you? 100 million, million, yeah. 200 million, 500 million? I don't know. Pick whatever sounds good, and you're going to get some of it for doing absolutely nothing. But if I could target you with something that means something to you, like, so the example I would use is, recently I got one, and it was from a school, and it was about my kid. And they said, "Your daughter needs to fill out this form for this thing." And I'm like, uh-oh, there's something I forgot to do, and I'm going to get yelled at. And I was literally reaching to click that button, and I went, "Oh, wait a minute, this is squirrely," and I backed off, or I would have very likely gotten phished. So these things expanded to all kinds of targeted attacks. So when hackers or other people buy or collect information about you, and they know that you're a customer of Bank X, they know that you use Store Y, any of that kind of information can give them that little tiny tidbit that's going to let them stick it to you, and that's a spear phishing attack rather than just a blanket phishing attack.
And Doug, what's the number one resource that hackers would use to find out information about you?
Well, they would use that thing that's called, the interweb. That's it. Yeah, the interweb, because, hey, I bet you Googled yourself.
Mm-hmm. Vanity search.
I mean, I know you're not supposed to do that, but you do it. You know, they tell you not to, but you did it anyway. I know you. I'm watching.
We have a professor at Roger Williams who Googled himself, and he found out too much to his dismay.
He's in jail now.
No, he was dead.
And, he was dead?
Yeah, they put his obituary on the side of the thing. And wow. So it took him 6 months and $10,000 to hire a lawyer, because Google said, basically, "We're just pulling this from the publisher's website." It was this, right?
Oh, wow.
And $10,000 and 6 months later, now finally he's back alive among the living. So,
well, yeah, and I mean, and if you put information out on the internet, guess what? People can get it very easily. But it goes beyond that. I mean, it goes into what's called the dark web, which is the ability of people are selling everything. If you go on, don't go on the dark web. Wait till we do a show about that, because
tour.
You don't want to go on there now. It's bad, really bad. But if you go on there, you can buy any kind of horrific stuff. I mean, the first time I ever went on there, and I mean, I've walked through Times Square in the 70s. It's not like it is today. If you didn't see it, you missed out. But I mean, I saw stuff I was absolutely shocked and dismayed by on the dark web, and you can buy information, and it's very valuable. So you can buy lists of people, and you see these hacks all the time, right? You see this on the news. Somebody says, a hacker sold all this information from this grocery store, and they bought 10,000 names. Or you got one of those letters. I got one of those letters about that, saying, "Hey, the U.S. government has lost your secret information, which contains all the information about your family, your life, and everything we know about you." And it's like, oh, great. That's so good to hear. But they do that, and that creates an even better opportunity to do these things. Another thing that they can do to you is they can use an attack on DNS. Mm-hmm. And you want to tell them about DNS? I'll let you tell them about DNS.
Yeah, so DNS stands for Domain Name Server, or DNS Server, as you hear. And it's one of the, you know, the big five types of servers that you need in a corporate or really any network. And a DNS, the way I describe it to my students, is it's like a phone book. And if you don't know what that is, Google it. Because, you know, phone books aren't really pervasive anymore.
That's the thing that was missing attached to the payphone.
And so back in the day, if you will, when we didn't have cell phones and so on and so forth, we would used to get this giant book out called the phone book. And we would look by last name or business based on the white pages or yellow pages, two different, one was for business, one was for people. So we would look up, let's say I wanted to call John Smith. I would look up S for Smith in the phone book and then look for John at a certain address, and then his phone number would be listed to the right. DNS functions in a similar way, where websites like eBay.com, which is a URL that you're familiar with, or Amazon.com or RWU.edu, all of these web addresses are formed by URL, or Universal Resource Locator. These URLs aren't understood by network computers. All network computers care about are IP addresses, okay?
Yay.
Which is like the phone number in the phone book. But we as humans can't memorize all of the IP addresses of all the machines that are out there, and they change sometimes. So that being said, they came up, you know, I don't know who developed DNS technology, but DNS ended up getting created, and now we don't have to memorize IP addresses like 10.110.20.50. We can just say, hey, computer, Siri, hey, Siri, I want to go to, take me to Amazon.com, and they pull up Amazon.com vis-a-vis DNS entries, which is a catalog or a phone book of all the different types of URLs and their IP addresses. Does that about sum it up?
Yeah, I mean, you don't want to try to remember 198.7.244.14 when you want to go to XXXpervert.com. you want to be able to go to XXXpervert.com. And that's what DNS was all about. Phishing allows hackers to jump in, mm-hmm. and maybe they change where that thing points.
Yep.
So if I can tell you that instead of calling 555-1212 to reach your friend's house, you dial 555-1213, and instead you get my house, but I can act like your friend. Now I just did a really old school kind of phishing attack on a fake phone book. And that's what people are doing with bad links when they start jumping into these things. And this is called DNS poisoning, DNS redirection, DNS attacks. And they can do this both globally, so they could do this like on a large scale, or they could do it on a regional DNS server, or they could even just do it on your computer. And one of the really good ways that you could phish someone, that sounded bad, the ways you should never phish someone would be to put something on a flash drive and let that something, a script, a program, a piece of software, malware, overwrite a file on your system called hosts. And every system's got a hosts file, and I can change things. And guess where your computer looks first?
It looks
in the host file.
Or LM hosts.
And if I go in there and change that on your host file on your Windows machine, when you type eBay.com, instead of going to eBay.com, you're going to end up in a bad, bad place that maybe you don't really realize is somewhere that you didn't get.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm sorry.
No, go for it.
Well, so I made a demo. It's not real exciting, but I showed you how a phishing attack could actually be used, and I'm going to let them play that demo for you right now.
Hi, this is Doug. So I wanted to show you an example of just how easy it is for you to get phished, and in this particular example, actually spear phished. So we were talking on the show about the difference between phishing and spear phishing and these kind of attacks. But this is a classic right here. So, and it was very easy for me to set up. So I took a domain that I owned at GoDaddy, and I created some email accounts. So this is all totally contrived, not actually abusing anyone. But I could easily have done this for the real deal. And I'm going to explain to you exactly how the attack works so that you understand why this is here. But the other problem with this is it's so easy to do. And it's so easy to get it done to you because I can target you with spear phishing type attacks. So this is a person that I made up named Jill Anoub. And Jill Anoub is has an email account at this domain called talipus.net. You can see it up here in the corner. And basically, Jill is a person who had put her resume out on the internet to try and find a job. So she put some resumes out there. And and at some point in time, someone found out somehow, and they could just be guessing. I mean, they don't have to actually know anything, but they could just be guessing that Jill is a customer of fake bank. Ooh, I better be careful there. I mean, I don't want Zuckerberg's goons coming after me. And it's like, was somebody out? No, okay, I'm just kidding. I could have made like a thumping noise and you hear me being dragged out of the building or something. Like, no, no, I accidentally said Facebook. I did not mean Facebook. I meant fake bank, but you know, Facebook, fake bank, fake book, whatever. So if Jill, and so I want to show you how easy this is to do, and I want to explain a couple of things about how easy it is to get drawn into it, and I also want to show you a couple of things about where you should be aware, why you need to be cautious, and how you can be a little more cautious. I can't really save you from this. That's why it's so prevalent. Because if you cooperate, it's over. They're going to get you. So Jill gets an email, and one thing that makes this a little less realistic is there's not 50 emails here, because it, you know, when this is just lost in the noise, it gets even more difficult, because you get all these emails and you're just sort of going through them trying to figure out what's going on. So she gets an email here from dphelps@goatgrabber.com, and it says job. She's looking for a job. Oh man, she just got a hit on her resume she put out on the internet somewhere. So she's very happy because she says, oh, I got a job opportunity. Now, Dee Phelps, who is the hacker, has gone and gotten her resume from some public place that she put it and knows that. And guess what? She put her email address on her resume and on all this. So that person was able to get a lot of info about her. And in this particular case, we're sort of assuming it's a spear phishing attack. So she clicks on it. Now, clicking on this email and opening it is not bad. Opening an email doesn't necessarily do anything or cause any kind of grief to you, as long as you have certain basic security stuff, you know, on your machine, which pretty much all email clients have by default now. But, you know, if you're worried, you might want to look into it. She sees that this guy sent her an email. You can see when it was sent. And these are real emails that I sent to myself. So if, you know, this is kind of like one of those creepy things you're doing in your office at home, like making up people and problems. Thinks this Jill's got her actual name on it. But guess what? How hard was it to get her name? Her email address has got her name in it. We found your resume online and Fake Bank is super interested. Yay. So I've already, and I didn't make an effort at this, so I didn't even think about the psychology of it. I just threw it together, and I literally spent about 15 minutes putting this whole deal together, and I'll show you the rest of it in a little bit. We found it, and they're super interested. You get this nice hook right up front. Found your resume online. Yay, I'm looking for a job. Fake Bank is super interested. Yay, they're interested in me. They like me. Oh, boy. You see, we have this new program where we hire a current bank customer from a random town for a high-paying executive job at our bank. Now, this sounds ridiculous to me, but I want to flag this part right here because I want to talk to you about it for a second. You don't have to do this in public. People will think you're crazy or it'll be dangerous. Take something that means something to you and put it in this sentence. You can take all the rest of this out. Put something here that's going to get your attention, like your kid. The last time I almost clicked on one of these by being stupid was something about my kid. And somebody said, your kid, you know, you need to fill out a form for your kid's school. And you go, oh, yeah, okay. And you immediately go right to it. And I went, whoa, why, you know, this seems a little crazy. I just made one up here that says we have this new program. It's a silly thing. But put something in that line that means something to you. You just applied for a loan. You're trying to get into college. You're trying to pass your final exam. Whatever it is, something that gets your eye right here that makes this sound good to you is going to be a nice thing. I went on and, of course, got carried away with it and said, we pay all your fees and get you a license to be a professional Henway in the banking industry. You see federal regulation, you love to use this kind of language because no one would ever use the word federal without proper authority. we see federal regulation requires that we do this, and I know it's silly, but we have to do it, so you got lucky. No prior experience, just go to our site and submit your resume file. Use your regular fake bank login, and you'll be good to go. Expect to hear from us in 3 to 4 weeks, it's misspelled. I actually did it on purpose because I wanted to show you something. So every symptom, every horrible symptom of a phishing attack is in this email, but it is so easy because all you got to do to achieve your dreams is click this link, right? Wow. Misspell words, very common. Misspell the word here, and that catches my eye because I misspell, I don't know, I have a thing about misspelled words. That immediately flags it for me. Did I even see this, though? I was so busy. I read the first line and said, oh, we're going to hire you. Click. If I'm lucky, they didn't even read this. This part's a little bit, if I was really doing this evilly, I probably would. I know I sound like a class on how to rob people. I probably wouldn't put this in here because that's where it starts to sound a little bit, you know, a little snaky. And I don't need to put that in there because it's going to ask me for that in a minute. They pay all my fees. They're going to get me a license. It's some kind of federal thing I got to do, and I need a job anyway. I'm good to go. So I look at this link that's here, and look at it. It's HTTPS. Now, some of you probably don't know what HTTPS is. I wouldn't be at all surprised if you don't know what that is, but some people do. And you go, oh, it's secure. It's a secure website. Yay. And then it's actually fakebank.com/lucky customer. Okay, well, wow. You know, what am I going to, I mean, why would I not click this? So I'm going to put my mouse over on it. Look at the call out. The call out even says fakebank.com. Wow. But that's not where you need to be looking. I'm going to move the mouse for a second. You won't be able to see it. But I want you to watch right down here. In the lower left-hand corner, I want you to watch right there when I put the mouse back on this link. Look what it says down there now. It says spreezero.com. Now, this is one of the most critical things you have to do if you want to avoid getting spearfished or phished. Whenever you get an email, even if it's from somebody you know, and it asks you to click a link, you have got to do this. And it's just something you're going to have to train your brain to do. Because if you don't do it, you're going to get popped. I promise. And if you look right here, you immediately see the number one key symptom of spear phishing, phishing type attacks, a redirect link. Now, there is really tricky ways I could have done this, too, if I wanted to take some more time and set it up. And we'll talk about some of those on the show, and it will scare you a whole lot more. But this one, if I just took the time to look right here, I see that this link doesn't go to Fake Bank at all. It actually goes to Spree Zero, whatever that is. And so it's not actually an HTTPS link to Fake Bank. It's a link to something called spreezero.com. And that's kind of scary. Mix that in with it's too good to be true. So for me, and again, I'm telling you, you're sitting here right now looking at this one going, no way, man. I would never fall for that crap. But that's not necessarily true. All of us have got things that are going to push our buttons. It could be something that gets you mad, it gets you happy, it gets you wanting something, especially if it's a spear phishing attack. I need a job. I'm unemployed. I'm scared. I need a job. And here is one. I'm there, dude. So this person, let's just say Jill clicks this link. She thinks she's going to fakebank.com. So when I click this link, look what I get. I actually get CV submission. Oh, wow. I can put my information in. So I'm going to put it in for her. Talibus. Why do you think I want her to up this like Dora the Explorer now? Why would I want her to upload her CV or resume? Well, guess what? If she uploads her resume, I just got a whole pile of information about poor Jill, who's going to be in deep, deep trouble from me. And then down here is my favorite. I can put in and her password is 777. And if she hits this submit link, I own her. And I just got her bank login and password. I got her I got her resume. I got her name. And this is a phishing attack, plain and simple. If she takes a second and she notices that the header up here is no longer secured, and that the header up here is warning that there's site information about this, she may be very seriously reluctant to put information in here. I would be. And you can see that this and it would be very easy for me to take this and make it look like a regular bank site. So just as a last sort of add-on to this, and as this demo went on longer than I planned, let me find something I can click up here that's going to get me in trouble. And let's go to Citizens Bank just for a second. Citizens Bank Online. The thing that you should take note of, and this is just for everybody there at home, see this thing right here? It doesn't have to say HTTPS, but if it does say, have a little padlock right there, and this is in Chrome, if it's got a little padlock right there, what it means is that they have an encrypted certificate, and that encrypted certificate is going to be able to validate that this website is what I think it is. So that means that I am actually at citizensbank.com. Now, I could get redirected. There's all kinds of ways I could cheat you at this, but at least that starting point. So instead of that starting point being at free zero up here, where you don't see the padlock, you don't see anything, because this is a regular unencrypted website, and it doesn't match. To me, that's one of the most damaging pieces of this whole thing. But if I go back and look at the email, I've got multiple clues, but I also have multiple hooks trying to get me to do this. Found your resume. We're really interested. High-paying executive job. Pay all your fees and get you a professional Henway license. Federal regulation. All these good things. And I could obviously make this so much more official. I could put a title, I could put a phone number, I could put all kinds of information here. But this person who needs a job is really excited and they click this link. They go straight to Spree Zero and they fill out this form and upload their resume. And guess what? I got your username and your password at Fake Bank. That is a very basic kind of spear phishing attack. Now, obviously, we on the show, we're going to talk about other kinds of spear phishing attacks, which embed malware, which do all kinds of things. But I could just as easily have had you click a link and embed malware on your machine. That's a sneakier thing to do, but this is pretty sneaky. She goes ahead and does this, and then a screen pops up and says, thank you. And, you know, I don't know if it doesn't, and it actually says it's required. Oh, I got to upload something? Oh, no. Oh, we can get some pictures. I'll upload a creepy picture of myself. There we go. Let's just upload that. And it says disabled, so I didn't set it up because I don't want anybody using it, but basically it could say thank you right there and say, you know, we'll be in touch. And she sits back and waits for a week while I'm emptying her bank account. So, you know, that's a spear phishing type attack. Okay, back to the show.
See how easy that is to do? Setting that demo up, you know how long it took me to do that? It took me about 10 minutes to set that up with the email account. So I built a web server. I went out. I generated a form. I mean, it's so easy to do. So I guess the thing we got to get to then is, what do you do about this stuff? And we want to talk a little bit about some different things you can use. But the biggest thing that you can use is your brain, because the real problem here is it's a classic con. Con stands for confidence. That's where the term came from. I have to instill confidence in me through you. I have to get you to believe what I'm saying to you, that you ought to give me money. That, you know, I mean, I can start some kind of rant here and try to get you to send in money to me for, you know, whatever kind of horrible thing I want to get you to send to support black t-shirts or something like that, because they're so needy. But these attacks depend on you and you rushing through this thing. So just like you saw in the demo, there were plenty of clues, but there was that one key thing that got you. The thing that got you was you wanted a job or whatever that thing was. And because of that, you jumped on it. You clicked that link and now you've got a problem. So The real first thing you have to do, if you want to avoid this from this perspective, is checking all your links. So remember that mouse over. Remember when you put your mouse in there, don't go to something that doesn't match up because that's going to be a real problem. I'll let Russ talk for a second.
Yeah, you know, so common sense and your brain are two of the most important tools that you can use. Like Doug said, if something doesn't seem right or it seems too good to be true, it probably is. You've heard that phrase before, I'm sure. Always check to make sure that as you mouse over links in emails, that when it previews the link or the address, you look at that preview and it actually is yourbank.com and not your, you know, htvyxw.com. I mean, that doesn't make any sense. But so verify the links, we have some products that we want to talk about also, which can help save you, you know, a lot of heartache and money should this happen too.
So it's you know, one thing I could do as a programmer, I could certainly write a piece of malware to do this stuff to you. And maybe you pick that flash drive up. And there was a really famous case of some spies throwing flash drives over the fences of, like, government parking lots trying to get people to take things inside. If I get a piece of malware on your system, that's a much more subtle kind of attack than even you clicking this link. Because now I don't have to get you to click the link. I can export things off your machine. So one of the things that you're going to have to be very careful about is about malware. And I run a product called Malware Bytes, which is a free product that you can get on the internet. You can pay for it too. They have different licensing, so I don't want to tell you something wrong. But I run Malware Bytes on my machines because I want to be careful. And I do bring a lot of stray stuff home because I take things to school. I take things to consulting jobs. I take things to police agencies that I'm working for. And I bring all that stuff back home. And it's very easy to forget and say, I brought this from the lab. And it's laying on my desk, and, oh, I need a flash drive, and you plug it in. And I've seen so much malware come through on removable media that you definitely need something like Malware Bytes running.
We had a situation happen maybe about 4 months ago. You may have heard of this phenomena called Crypto Locker. What this is it gets inside your computer most of the time through flash drives or rogue media or something like that, or email and websites too. Phishing scams, and it gets into your computer, and it encrypts all of your files, and it comes up with a small window when you boot your computer the next time, and a screen says, your files have been encrypted, blah, 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 please send a $250 payment in Bitcoin to XYZ, blah, blah, blah. You know, and then we'll unencrypt your files. You have until Friday to do this. So that's a summary of basically what this thing is. So we got hit with this at the university at a very specific computer because an individual, which we trace back to, put a flash drive into the USB port of an administrative assistance machine. That crypto virus spread through not only that machine, infecting it, but it also encrypted the network share that had all of our important documents on it.
And I will tell you, I was just reading about there's new variants of crypto. We'll do a whole show on Crypto Locker, yep. I promise. But there are new variants of Crypto Locker that can actually spread across network drives and cloud drives that are connected to your machine too. So make backups.
Make backups.
If I don't say anything else about Crypto Locker now, make backups.
Yep. Make backups. Practice safe computing. Okay.
That's right.
Know what you're putting into your USB drive before you put it in. And if you don't, run in a test environment with a non-network connected computer that you don't care about. To test
all that sounds vaguely dirty.
And that's what computers are, vaguely dirty. So Malware Bytes.
Antivirus. Mm-hmm. And I mean, pretty much, to me, all the antivirus stuff that's out there is about the same. Mm-hmm. In terms of it's based on signatures. Mm-hmm. So that means that it only knows what it's seen. Right. So antivirus does have some ability to respond actively, but mostly you need to have it in place. And again, antivirus can act to prevent things from being written to your computer. Mm-hmm. So if you plug that flash drive in, it may get scanned. If you've got an email and it's got an attachment to it, it may get scanned. But you can't count on that. So you still have to use common sense. So when you're getting, I get emails all the time from people I don't know. And I get emails sometimes from people I do know that say, oh, open this file. file. It's got a picture of my granddaughter. I'm like, I don't care. I'm like, what? Why would I care?
Right.
But I don't open it. But a lot of people might. Right. And so if you're sitting out there watching this and you're going, I get those kind of emails too, because it's very easy to write a piece of software to do that. Yep. So if I can take that piece of malware to reach into your address book and email all your friends and your contacts, mm-hmm. they're going to get those same things. Yeah. And this is, starts turning to worm attacks and all these other kind of things that go on. And so you need that antivirus there.
You do. And it's important also to emphasize that, or to put emphasis on the fact that these are signature-based and they are retroactive only. A signature cannot be created for an antivirus program, meaning an update that that looks for new infections. It cannot be created until it's released in the wild. So, you know, it's like a flu vaccine, if you will. I mean, the flu vaccine contains small little strands or small samples of a particular strand of influenza. So every year, the vaccine changes a little bit because there are different strains and so on. Same thing with antivirus. But if it comes down to should I vaccinate my computer by getting antivirus or not, are you a vaxxer or anti-vaxxer, always err on the side of caution. I would say absolutely. Go. I mean, it can't hurt.
Yeah.
Now, the most important question, or I guess the most popular question that we're asked or that I'm asked regularly is, should I invest in antivirus, meaning pay for it, or should I go with a free solution? And that really comes down to, I personally think that there are some great free solutions out there. I typically, can we mention brands on the show?
I don't know. Rustin, we don't know. Can we mention brands? So don't mention any brands, because they have to pay us.
I typically go, if I'm going to pay for a subscription to an antivirus, I typically go with one brand that begins with an S, because that's just what I grew up on, and another brand that begins with an M. So those two are the biggest pay ones, and I've used those in the past, and I like them. And then for the free version, since they're free, I mean, we must be able to. So like Avast, which is one that I use that's free.
He says it all fancy.
Avast.
I called it Avast.
Avast.
Because I'm just like a hillbilly type. So
and then
it's like,
what are some other ones?
I use Avast.
What are some other ones free? Avast.
I don't have any other free ones. I do have Avast, but I have Avast a lot of things.
Avast what?
Yeah, but I mean, I don't know. I mean, I think you have to find an antivirus solution that kind of. We'll do a show on that too someday.
Sure.
But I mean, I think you just as long you need something.
You need something. Yeah.
And but you can't get dependent on it.
Right.
You still have to have good hygiene practices, just like flu vaccines. If you go around kissing people and you know, like the subway or licking the subway pole, I saw a kid doing that once. It was just like, it was just I mean, the bottom line is that if you have terrible hygiene practices, you're probably going to get sick anyway. And if you do a lot of exchanges and swaps and you're constantly moving stuff through there, you have a lot more risk than somebody who says, I have one computer, I don't even use the internet.
Right.
All I do is use it to, I don't know what you would use it for, but whatever you use it for. The other thing I want to tell you about as we start to wrap up, be skeptical. I'm a cynic, and I always have been, and I'm paranoid, and that makes me a great like disaster recovery planning guy, because you know when I walk in the atrium of a company, I'm immediately going, wow, what if all that fell? You know, other people go, isn't it beautiful? I'm like, wow, what if that fell? Wouldn't that be a mess? But that's why I get paid to do that. I want to tell you about a website that you should support, and if you don't, please do. Snopes.com. They don't pay me to say that. Snopes, SNOPES.com. If you see one of these things, when you get that letter that says, I am a Nigerian prince and I'm going to give you $100 million, if you go to Snopes and type it in, probably it's already on there. Same thing with these things like you see on Facebook and other products, like Bill Gates is going to give you $50 if you forward this to 50 friends. And then he'll give you $500. And I'm like, why didn't he just say $5,000?
Oh, that for each friend that you forward it to.
Well, I know. And then they say that doesn't sound realistic.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, oh, really? It's like, okay. But Snopes.org has pretty much every kind of scam and all these kind of things on there. So all these malware scams, all these phishing scams that are known. The other one, I found some anti-phishing working groups.
Yep.
There's one called Anti-Phishing Working Group, if you imagine that, mm-hmm. which is antiphishing.org. They have lists of phishing attacks that are common. So if you're in a company or even at home and you want to check out like what the latest ones are, mm-hmm. because you'll see the same stuff coming round and round. And you can buy these on the dark web. So you can actually go on the dark web and buy phishing attacks now. And they'll even do them for you if you want. Mm-hmm. So you can just hire it out, which is, you know, I like that. It's just like calling AAA.
Well, when I'm on the dark web, I prefer to spend most of my time on the Silk Road. So,
yeah, you didn't hear that here. But so I think that's where we're going to wrap that up right about there. And that was our really quick and dirty talk about phishing. And, mm-hmm. and the biggest thing I would say take away from this is be careful and be skeptical. Mm-hmm. And that's going to help you focus on avoiding anti-phishing attacks. So nothing is ever free, really. Mm-hmm. All right. So I'm Doug White.
I'm Russ Boschman.
Thanks for tuning in to the show. We hope you enjoyed it.
We'll see you next week.
Send your questions. Bye.